And for Rachel's first solo exhibition at the gallery, even though she's been around in the gallery for years and years and around with her art, and she's a very supportive artist for other artists, so it's a really, she's got a generous spirit and we're very happy to have her. She asked Karen because Rachel, I have to say, is always interested in the environment, and all her work is always environmentally and social conscience, trying to prick our social consciences. So she invited Karen, and I have to say I did look Karen up because it's sort of, she has a vague title. For those of you who don't know her, she has a PhD in ecology and biology of the salt marsh plant, which is amazing. And at the moment she's a scientific officer in charge of the Rainforest Conservation Project, and this is a rainforest exhibition. And she assists in the storage of suitable seeds through seed banking and continues to research alternative measures for storing seeds not suitable for standard techniques, which I actually think is really interesting considering all in terms of agriculture as well. So we welcome you, thank you, and please, over to you.
Thank you so much for inviting me. It's actually a real pleasure to be presenting a collection of works that is on a subject so close to my heart. So I'm a rainforest conservation scientist, and I'm never entirely sure what to tell people that title means, but basically I work on the conservation of rainforest seeds. And I work at the Australian Plant Bank, which is based out of the Australian Botanic Garden, Mount Annan, and that's a branch of the Sydney Botanic Garden that we know probably a bit better than the garden Mount Annan. So we have a seed bank out there, and main goal in life at the moment is to fill that seed bank with seed for all the native species of New South Wales. And in order to go into that seed bank, they need to fulfill certain criteria. So they have to be tolerant of being dried down to a really low moisture content. And they have to be happy to be vacuum sealed into a little foil packet and thrown in a big freezer at minus 20 degrees. And you'd be surprised at the number of species we can do that with. So probably about 80% of the Australian flora we can store that way. So you're talking about the gum trees, the wattles, the bottle brushes, the paper barks, all perfectly happy to be put in the freezer, and we can pull them out again decades, in some cases hundreds of years later, and they will still germinate. So that's 80% of the flora. The rainforest plants, not so happy. We've had them in the too hard basket up until about 6 years ago. And then we decided, okay, well, maybe it's time we sort of confronted them. They had a reputation for being not storable because they were not happy to be dried out. So we thought, okay, well, we're going to test that and see if it's actually true. So the last 6 years we've been going and collecting as many seeds as we could, and we put them through a procedure where we germinate them while they're fresh, and then we dry some of the seeds out and we'll see if they'll still germinate. And if they're happy with that, then we'll catch them up and put them in the freezer, and then see if they'll still germinate after they've been frozen and thawed. And sometimes that process can take up to 2 years to get an answer because the darn things take so bloody long to germinate. So in some cases they're quite quick, but quite a few of them have what we call seed dormancy. So they're geared up not to germinate straight away, which is completely in the face of the current thinking about rainforest, in that they, most people think that rainforest seeds will germinate as soon as they drop to the ground. They don't. So it's been an interesting process. And one of the things that I'm often asked, since I've been working on rainforest seeds, is there much rainforest in Australia? And there is. Not as much as you find in the Amazon, not as much as you would find in Papua New Guinea, but more than you find in New Zealand or even in Caledonia. So, and actually 50 million years ago, Australia was mostly covered in rainforest. Mm-hmm. And the continent started drifting, the climate dried out, and the rainforest started getting replaced with the sort of eucalypt vegetation that we see dominating the continent today. The rainforests that we have left now form a sort of a discontinuous band all down the east coast in the higher rainfall areas, from northern Queensland down to Victoria, and also on the west coast of Tasmania, and in the north around Darwin and in the monsoon areas. So the look of rainforest can vary quite a lot, depending on the latitude, depending on how much rain you get, depending on your altitude, and what the soil type is. So the sort of rainforest that most people would probably be familiar with is the tropical rainforest that grows in the Daintree and that Rachel's been working on. And that has a tremendous complexity of different tree species. Within a hectare, you can find more than 120 different tree species. Huge variety of different vines with enormously thick trunks, palms, epiphytes, you've got staghorns and elkhorns and orchids growing off the trees, and it's just one complex web of plant life. Very, very interesting to walk into and to look at, and actually these paintings have been reminding me of one little foray into a rainforest in northern New South Wales a couple of years ago. I walked into a forest of Nothofagus. I'm sorry, I can't remember what the common name is. I've been scratching my brain to remember what that is all for the last hour. Anyway, enormous tree trunks. You couldn't put your arms around them. They were just fantastic. And I looked up, every single tree had its own community of ferns and mosses and lichens and orchids, all just growing entirely up the trunk. It was just magic. And then it started to rain and it was all misty. And it was just one of those special moments. So rainforest around the world actually doesn't occupy that much of the land mass available. But despite that, they hold 50% of the diversity of plant species and animal species in the world. And it's a huge amount of diversity in a very small space. And they produce 20% of the oxygen we're currently breathing. They soak up huge amounts of carbon dioxide. They are the source of some of our favourite foods. Macadamias, bananas, avocados, mangoes, chocolates, coffee, all the good stuff originally from rainforest, and in some cases still grown in rainforest. And those rainforests are still incredibly important to a lot of indigenous communities for their basic living, so for their food, for their medicines, for their materials for building. So that makes it kind of disheartening to know that the 12% rainforest coverage that we did have has now been reduced to 6%. And there's massive land clearing still going on in the South Pacific, in Southeast Asia, and in the Amazon. So we're very lucky in Australia that our land clearing is mostly finished. And a lot of the rainforest we have left is now protected. But there was a period in the 1800s to early 1900s where rainforest was basically free game. And it was looked on as really good value for timber and agricultural land. So the areas like the Big Scrub in northern New South Wales, which was 75,000 continuous hectares of subtropical rainforest, and between 1860 and 1900, that was mowed down to a few pockets that now total about 100 hectares. It's a huge loss of diversity that, you know, is very, very hard to get back. But even set with that, we've lost about a third of the rainforest that we had before European settlement, but still that still has an amazing amount of biodiversity in it. So more than 3,500 seed-producing plants, hundreds more ferns, hundreds more mosses, hundreds more lichens, all the plant and animal species that provides habitat for. So it's really important that we look after what's left. So with the seed conservation project that we're working on, our aim is to try and get the rainforest seeds into the seed bank as much as we can as a safeguard against extinction. And this is really important when you have the fragments of rainforest that we have now, because they're much more susceptible to secondary effects. They're more susceptible to weed invasion, they're more susceptible to fire, more susceptible to feral pests and also diseases. And there was a disease that arrived in 2010 called myrtle rust that is having a dreadful effect on some of our species. So this affects over 400 different species in the Myrtaceae family, which is the family that has our eucalypts and the bottle rushes and the melaleucas, and quite a number of species that grow in rainforest. So there are two rainforest species already that in the last 8 years have gone from being common to critically endangered because they've been so badly defoliated that they can't produce seed in the wild. So it's our aim to try and get species like that into preservation before they go extinct, so that if we can at some stage put them back into the wild where the disease isn't present, then we have a chance to keep them alive. So one of the difficulties with working on rainforest is it can be quite difficult to communicate the importance of it and the value of it when there's no rainforest anywhere to be seen nearby. So this is where artists like Rachel are really valuable. And if you have a look at her work, you will see just how much diversity there is in rainforest. And I can look at these and picture myself in the dane tree. Huge trunks, can't see the canopy, trunks covered in vines, huge amount of undergrowth, all tangled, lots of different species. And that's what a rainforest is, and that's really worth preserving. So without further ado, I'd like to declare this exhibition open and invite you to enjoy Rachel's work.
Thank you.